the chairman of the Academic Senate of the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Dr. Apotekar Iskandar Syah, Magister Science. All managers, head of program studies, and coordinators of the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, and also the honorable speaker for today's lecture, Professor Apotekar Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD, from the Laboratory of Pharmaceutics and Pharmaceutical Technology, Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia. The honorable moderator who will be moderating today's session, Apotekar Arief Kurniawan, Magister Farmasi, from the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia. The honorable professors, lecturers, and all faculty members who are attending today's lecture. And last but not least, I would also like to greet all the participants who are present today. Once again, welcome everyone to FFUI's first ever virtual summer course, 2022 Advances in Pharmaceutical Science. As an introduction, this summer course is aimed for students and fresh graduates who are greatly interested in increasing their knowledge of pharmaceutical sciences with an even broader perspective. For that purpose, we have invited numerous professors and lecturers from Universitas Indonesia, as well as other well-known universities abroad. And today we'll be having our eighth and last lecture of the entire summer course, which will be given by the Honorable Professor Apotekar Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD, with the title of the lecture being Transdermal Drug Delivery System Based on Herbal Bioactives Using Nanocarriers. Before we start, I will explain to you the agenda for today's lecture. Today's lecture will be started off by an opening remark by the Master of Ceremony, followed by the main lecture session for about an hour, which will be followed by a one-hour discussion time. And then the event will be continued with a handover of some certificates of appreciation for both our speaker and moderator. Next up, we'll be having a cultural session and networking event for the participants. And then the event will be concluded by a closing remark from the Dean of the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Professor Dr. Apotekar Arianwar, Magister Science. Now, we will finally move on to our main agenda, which is the eighth lecture of the entire summer course, which will be presented by Professor Apotekar Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD, and moderated by Apotekar Arief Kurniawan, Magister Farmasi. Before we begin the lecture, please allow me to read Mr. Arief Kurniawan's CV as today's moderator. Arief Kurniawan obtained his Bachelor of Pharmacy and Professional Pharmacist degree in the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia. In 2015, he began his career as a production officer at PT Dexa Medica site Palembang, where he started in the packaging production area, and then he moved to the sterile and non-sterile cephalosporin production lines in 2017. In 2019, he continued to take a master's degree in pharmaceutical science, and now he's joining as an academic member in the Laboratory of Pharmaceutics and Pharmaceutical Technology, Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia. Currently, he's developing a huge interest in the application of 3D printing technology for making drug delivery systems. Now, without further ado, please welcome our honorable moderator, Apotekar Arief Kurniawan, Magister Farmasi. To Mr. Arief, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Heidi, for the introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Arief Kurniawan, and I will be your moderator for today's virtual summer course lecture. The topic is transdermal drug delivery system based on herbal bioactives using nanocarriers. Before we begin the lecture, please allow me to read the CV of our speaker for today's session. Professor Apotekar Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD, is currently working as a professor and head of the Laboratory of Pharmaceutics and Pharmaceutical Technology, Faculty of Pharmacy, Universitas Indonesia. She is also a member of Academic Commission in Academic Senate, Universitas Indonesia. Professor Sylvia Surini obtained her Bachelor and Professional Pharmacist degree from Universitas Indonesia, and then she continued her studies towards a master's and doctoral program at Hoshi University, Tokyo, Japan, and she got her master's and doctorate in 2002 and 2005, respectively. Her expertise areas are in pharmaceutics, pharmaceutical technology, drug delivery systems, pharmaceutical excipients, as well as cosmetics and cosmetology. She has 3 patents and numerous scientific publications in reputable journals related to development of drug delivery systems. And one of her most recent publications is titled Androglyphalate Loaded Ethosomal Gel for Transdermal Application, Formulation, and In Vitro Penetration Study, which is also related to the topic of today's lecture. All right, without further ado, please welcome our honorable lecturer, Professor Apotekar Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD. To Prof. Sylvie, the time and screen are yours.
Thank you, Mr. Arif, for introducing me well. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Please let me prepare my presentation. I cannot share screen. Maybe a host can be help me. Yeah. During waiting for the host, I'd like to thanks to the committee that already give me opportunity to share the lecture today, and also the participant that joined the summer course 2022, which held by Faculty of Pharmacy Universitas Indonesia, particularly in this topic today. May I try? Okay. Okay. Can you see, check the my screen?
Yes, prof. It's clear.
Yeah. Today's topic is about pharmaceutical technology and also pharmaceutics. Today I will deliver a lecture with a topic of transdermal drug delivery systems based on herbal bioactives using nanocarriers. Yeah, this is my outline for the lecture today. I divided my lecture to be four steps. First, about the concept of transdermal drug delivery system, including advantages and disadvantages, about skin penetration, ideal drugs for transdermal drug delivery system, and factors affecting percutaneous absorption, and also various transdermal patch. And the second part, it's about enhancement strategies for transdermal drug delivery system. And the third and fourth part is our research in the area of transdermal drug delivery system using herbal bioactive that enhancing to the skin absorption using nanocarrier. Here, I will deliver two kinds of nanocarrier: solid lipid nanoparticle and autosomal gel. Maybe we always hear about dermal or transdermal. Or maybe recently we hearing about transdermal, but actually we don't know or we cannot recognize which one transdermal or which one dermal dosage form. Here I give you seven cases. You can see in the picture 1 until 7. One is the like ointment, this like patch, and this maybe cream, this maybe a patch also, and others. Which one is a dermal and which one is transdermal? How to differentiate between dermal form and transdermal dosage form? because based on the historically, maybe start is the same starting. Both of them administered by topically. And on the skin, topically on the skin. And some dosage form here give effect locally, and some dosage form in this picture give systematic effects. Yeah, usually in the class I ask the student which one, but here maybe I will give the lecture fully. How to recognize some concept we can follow, such as like this. We differentiate how the uptake of the drug, if the uptake until systemic circulation or not, and where the dosage form apply on the skin, of course on the skin, but what kind of skin, healthy or diseased skin? It will guide us to differentiate which one dermal and which one transdermal dosage form. This here the picture is some example of transdermal dosage form. This long ago nitroglycerin transdermal system. This famous transdermal system page. And maybe the nicotine not maybe recently. The transdermal dosage form usually give a systemic circulation, not only on the skin, not only give effect on the dermal or in the skin, but can penetrate until dermis and absorb to systemic circulation. And for the transdermal drug delivery system or transdermal dosage form, usually apply on healthy skin. Like this, these are healthy skin. The skin placed to the transdermal dosage form should be healthy, not diseased skin, not a pathological skin. Why? Because this system already calculate for the release rate, or for the time how long the drug in this system can release or can penetrate through the skin. And for the dermal dosage form, dosage form not until systemic circulation. Maybe some can be until systemic circulation, but most of them give a local effect around the skin. And for the dermal dosage form, usually apply on diseased skins or pathological condition of skin. Like here, this is the first, this dermal dosage form, because this for maybe psoriasis or acne, like this. And here, maybe we cannot see clearly. This transdermal, because apply in the healthy skin. This one way to differentiate or recognize which one dermal and which one transdermal. Most of transdermal dosage form, the form in the page. And usually containing adhesive. Okay, I will explain next after this slide. Because of that, if we want to make a definition about transdermal drug delivery system, I try to make a conclusion or definition. The system is a topic body it should be topically and non-invasive drug delivery to the skin. 2, the systemic circulation with a controlled drug release rate, usually zero order, generally a single dose, generally, with a long period of use, for transdermal usually 1 to 7 days. And why this transdermal delivery nowadays is very attractive and fascinating to researcher or to development for the industry, development in industry, pharmaceutical industry, because they have some advantages here. First, less invasive when applied on the skin, because topically we just apply it on the skin and we don't need we don't feel a pain, just adhesive attached in the skin. We don't need to steps like a injection, and also no pain or some form like gel, just put in the skin or top in the skin. And another advantage is self-administration, because the form of this dosage form is gel or cream or patch, it is easily for the patients, easy for the patient to administer by themselves. It's like this, this lies just like patch, just open the liner and attached to the skin. The administration not need a help that person or that need a medical doctor or the nurse. And another advantage is this delivery, this drug delivery system can avoid first-pass metabolism or hepatic first-pass metabolism. Since this is not oral, so this directly from the dermis, our dermis directly absorbed into systemic circulation. And another is this also is on application, easy to apply. And for the preparation of the production, this delivery system have various dosage form, have model form, and many methods to prepare or to produce dosage form for transdermal delivery systems. Another advantage, transdermal dosage form can reduce the frequency of administration, because prolonged action. One single dose apply can for 1 to 7 days or more. So just apply once a day, the patient have an effect for a day full. So this is can improve patient improve the patient Beside many advantages, this dosage form have some disadvantages. As example, first, there are limited suitable drugs can be used in this dosage form. Some drug have special characteristic. Example, the drug should be a potent drug, which mean have the small dose for once administration. because in this dossier form, it should be contain a dose for using a long time, example for 7 days. So in one single dose should contain a dose for 7 days, example, or for 1 day. If in the oral administration use 4 times a day, so it means if you want to change the administration to transdermal, so it means in a single dose should be 4 times dose in one single dose dosage form. So if the dose high, it should be the system or the source form cannot use because it's too big a dosage form. And so just can use for the potent drug that use a small dose in one's times. Another disadvantage is because usually this page containing an excipient for adhesive, some excipient for adhesive, it may cause skin irritation at the application site, irritation on the skin for a few people. And when applied first time on the skin, the drug in the plasma or plasma level of the drug can be achieved slowly because the release of the drug is zero order. So usually they have some like time, so not like injection, not like oral tablet. Have a time to achieve a plasma level that can give the effect. Here's comparison between intravenous administration, oral and transdermal administration. As we know, for the oral administration, usually there is hepatic first pass effect. Yeah, for the transdermal, they don't have or less hepatic first pass effect. Almost the same with IV administration. And then, how about the level of drugs in the plasma in the blood plasma? For the oral, the drug level in the plasma is not a constant. Because of that, we usually check a drug more than once in a day. But for the transdermal, we can use a single dose once in a day until 7 days or 10 days. For the IV, it could be constant if administered by infuse, just a prolonged infuse. But for the IV injection, for a single dose small volume, it cannot keep a constant drug level. And how about the self-administration? First was the IV, the need the medics, and for the transdermal, can use by ourselves. And for the termination of therapy, if we get the wrong wrong drug or wrong dosage form. For the transdermal dosage form, we can just put off the patch. This means very easy to terminate the application of transdermal. Compared to the IV, it's very difficult because just give the antidote. And for oral, maybe can be or not. So if we compare according to this fourth point, we can see that transdermal delivery give some advantage, yeah, compared to IV administration and also oral administration. And how to designing transdermal drug delivery systems? First, we have to know about skin characteristic first, and as usual, we do some pre-formulation and also formulation. And the third knowledge about polymers and other excipient. Polymers is useful especially to formulate the patch of the or the carrier of the dosage form transdermal drug delivery systems. And we have to study how the transport of drug molecules from the transdermal dosage form penetrate to the skin and enter systemic circulation. And also the knowledge about pharmacology, including pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic. And this is also important, how to prepare dosage form, to formulate with apparatus, which instrument that we have to use, and how to packaging this dosage form. This one of the challenging for us to design also. Yeah, first this skin characteristic. This just for reminding again for the skin. As we know, skin consists of three layer: epidermis, dermis, and hypodermis. Epidermis itself consists of five layers, and the outer layer is stratum corneum. Here, stratum corneum. This stratum corneum, which we is the limited step penetration to stratum corneum, is limited step for skin penetration. How deep this drug from transdermal dosage form should enter? Since the effect is systemic, so the drug has to enter systemic circulation. So it should be enter here, blood vessel. But blood vessel blood vessels are in the dermis here. The dermis, maybe my cursor, I hope you can see here the dermis here. So we hope the drug here in the drug first the drug on the surface of the skin penetrate through stratum corneum and absorb until dermis, and then enter this blood enter the dermis and then enter systemic circulation. And circulate to all the body. And here are some problems with how to handle the limitation of satum corneum penetration. I forget to show you this layer of the epidermis. It's a 5 layers stratum corneum until stratum basale. This from top, yeah, on the top of our skin, stratum corneum. And between these 5 layers, the limitation is on stratum corneum. It's on stratum corneum. So if we can handle the stratum corneum limitation of penetration here, stratum corneum, usually the drug or the active ingredients can penetrate until this dermis and meet the circular systemic circulation. This also to reminding about the skin penetration. There are three routes of the second skin penetration. First, through transapantagial route here, submedial route, pore of hair follicle, and also through sweat duct. But this appendageal root or the pore or the transappendageal root is only 0.1% of the skin area. And the second one through transcellular or intracellular here. Through the cell penetrate through the cell and the third is inner cellular root between the cell. So even though this transappendageal root look easy to drag on the skin to penetrate, but we have to remember that the area very, very small compared to transepidermal root, even though intracellular or intercellular. The drug, if the transdermal delivery, the drug should enter until dermis. Here, some ideal properties of drug which can use for transdermal dosage form. You can see, I already explained about dose should be low and have half-life less than 8 hours. And have molecular weight less than 500 Dalton, and also a partition coefficient or log P between 1 to 4, have lyophilicity high lyophilicity, and usually low oral bioavailability, and have a low therapeutic index. And better if have a melting point less than 200 degrees Celsius. pH should also be not too acid or too base, between 5 until 9. This is the ideal properties of drug. Can we can we formulate a drug to be transdermal dosage-borne if the drug properties out of these properties, example, molecular weight more than 500 Dalton, or what you call lyophilicity is high, is low lyophilicity, example. Can we formulate this drug to be transdermal dosage form? The answer is yes. No. Because we can use many technology to improve or to enhance that not ideal drugs for transdermal, but we can still formulate this drug to be transdermal dosage form. These some factors that affecting percutaneous absorption. Some is physicochemical factor from active ingredients or from drugs. You can read here: potassium coefficient, solubility, ionization, molecular size, molecular weight, stability, or half life. And some biological factor according to the skin, the patient skin, such as skin age, skin condition, example dry or moist, and their regional skin site, where which part of the skin that we will apply this dosage form. And then how the skin metabolism and the effect of circulation in the skin. And also must difference if we use different species. Because of that, if we use animal for the research, actually maybe not so close, but we not the same with the human with the human skin. And then another factor is formulation factor. There's some interaction. We have to check if there is a drug skin interaction or not. This influenced by a formulation. Some formulation can enhance skin hydration, or some formulation facilitate binding between drug and skin, or the drug itself have a binding with the skin. Or we have to check if there is interaction between vehicle with the skin, and the interaction give a negative effect or a positive effect for penetration, for the skin penetration of the drug. And other interaction, and also composition, of course, composition, and how about the transport of this drug released from the carrier or is from the dosage form. Some transport theory, we have to understand here. Especially if you have to check our dosage form or our dosage form candidate for transdermal delivery, we have to consider if the diffusion from the dose of diffusion of the drug from the dosage form penetrate to the skin is passive diffusion or the passive diffusion or not, and when we do some research, we want to fix laws or not, fix one first and second laws or not. And then when we are setting the experiment, we have to remember about single dose steady state. And when we examine our dosage form, we need to calculate about lag time and also it is important flux value to proxy is important to determine the dose that the source maybe the characteristic of the transmembrane dosage form. On the market, some transdermal dosage form is in the form of page, the form page. Here are some model or scheme of the model of transdermal. The beginning or the all generation, for the first generation, the diffusion is passive. Usually they use example nitroglycerin ointment here. This all generation. The first generation, if seeing talk, even though using ointment, they hope the nitroglycerin can absorb, penetrate through the skin. And the next generation still use passive diffusion. This already in the form of patches, even the reservoir patch or matrix patch, and there are some gel and ointments. Three of these reservoir patch, matrix patch, gel and ointment should be penetrated through saturn corneum until the dermis. And the next generation, here, it use energy, use nanocarriers to improve the skin penetration of the drug. It's like this, metaldose pump here, or ion chloroplatic. This already on the market and microneedle maybe not yet. So in the clinic test, any clinically examination maybe. Here the basic component of transdermal drug delivery system. Usually, for the basic component, we have a first baking layer. We call it baking layer. How to baking layer? Maybe the top here. If we apply the patch, this is at the top, and then they have a drug reservoir or it depends on the type of the patch. If the reservoir type, they have a drug reservoir. And then they have red controlling membrane and consists of adhesive excipients and Renis liner, which will peel, when the form. This excipient, this liner. Here, this release liner, and we not use this release liner. Oh, here, and forget. Here you can read here. And some formulation need an excipient that we call permeation enhancer to enhance the drug penetration through the skin. Some type of transdermal patch here is we call single layer drug in adhesive. Here a very simple patch formulation, only baking layer, and consists adhesive excipient, which consisting or which containing drug active active ingredients here. Just mix in the matrix, but the matrix is the adhesive excipient and close with a liner, excipient liner. And the second one, to improve the drug release, improve what we call improve, to be control release, to be control release, to be zero order, some formulation use additional membrane, like in the second, this membrane, not only adhesive as a function that have a function, also not only adhesive, but also to control the drug release. But here in the second type, the formulation need another membrane to promote control release, to promote zero order release. So they have membrane here and a double. Here, this difference in the first one, it is the first close to the skin, this drug in this adhesive will release first and maybe fast compared to the second one, because the second one protect first with the membrane, so diffuse more slowly compared the drug in here. And the third type is a matrix patch. In this type, adhesive layer containing adhesive excipient not contain drug. This only for adhesive. This only for adhesive. So this type need another excipient as a matrix. Even the matrix can be adhesive also or not. Yeah. Can be adhesive matrix or not adhesive matrix, because it's already have adhesive layer. And here, you're using a polymer. Polymer that can control how the drug release from this matrix. And another type is a reservoir patch. Drug here not dispersed in the polymer or not dispersed in the controlling polymer, red contouring polymer, but the drug in the core in the form of gel or solution. But gel or solution here not have a function for controlling the drug release. Which have controlling drug release is this membrane here, the what we call green one, this membrane. Yeah. So the membrane will control diffusion of the drug from the drug reservoir. Example, drug reservoir is in the solution. Drug solution, solution, and drug solution can diffuse through this membrane. This membrane not containing drug, and here also use adhesive to put in the skin of course. So it's different actually. So in this type, the rule of the membrane here is for controlling of the drug release, for controlling the drug release in zero order. But the third type here, that controlling is a matrix here, matrix that mixed with the drugs. And I'll continue another Personality type. This model of personal dosage form, personal dosage form on the market, many type, and because to penetrate across the stratum corneum, actually is not easy, especially for drugs that not have ideal properties to ideal properties for transdermal drug delivery. Example, if the drug have high molecular weight more than 500 Dalton, or the drug too very hydrophilic, sample, and many causes. Because actually stratum corneum is like a cover of our body. So in that case, we use a chemical enhancer, or use a micron or nanocarrier, or we use physical enhancement device like microneedles, ion topheresis or sonophoresis or electroporation and others that we were, that I will explain next time. There's something wrong here. I'm sorry, there's something wrong in my presentation. Yeah, I'm sorry. Now, here the second part. Yeah. Some obstacle or some challenge of the active ingredient or from active pharmaceutical ingredients. So some pharmaceutical, some transdermal dosage form need something to enhance skin penetration. many methods or many ways to enhance skin penetration. These are divided by few group. First, we make drug and vehicle interaction. Sample, we use prodrug. It means if the drug not easy, maybe too hydrophilic or too polar and low penetration through the skin. So we can prepare or we can choose prodrug form. If the prodrug form more hydrophilic, more easier penetrate to the skin, choose prodrug. And if the prodrug enter the dermis and enter the blood vessel, it can be metabolized to be a drug, or use ion pairing. It's also almost the same. we choose the pair, this pair of the ionic drug. And all use aesthetic system. Mix the drug with other excipient that make system aesthetic system. And the most applicable technique is stratum corneum modification. First, hydration. Hydration usually already facilitated by dosage form. Example, if we use a cream to skin, cream usually contain water, and water can hydrate our skin. Or cream contain propylene glycol, hydroalcohol, propylene glycol, it can function as a humectant and can protect evaporation, water evaporation from the skin, from our skin, or use an excipient that can be occlusive on the skin, so also avoid water evaporation from our skin. Or we can use a chemical enhancer here. Here are some chemical enhancer that usual use in from dosage form, in transdermal dosage form. You can use sulfoxide, azone, pyrrolidone, urea alcohol, surfactant, protection, and terpene. These are the family. Usually, chemical enhancer function by disrupting the lipid bilayer of the lipid bilayer of stratum corneum and interacting with the protein or modifying the partition coefficient of the drug. And this all chemical enhancer must be, of course, inert, non-toxic, non-allergenic, and non-irritant. And preferable, elicit rapid effect on the skin and aesthetically accepted. Maybe a good smell, sample, and crucially, skin barrier function must recover quickly after the chemical has been removed. Why? Here, because actually this chemical enhancer affecting the skin penetration by disrupting the lipid bilayer. But this disrupting just not for a long time. Only when the dosage form still using, and when we finish application of the dosage form, this disrupting, this interaction and others rapidly remove. So the skin back to the normal there. And another method is using physical and particle. Here I divide into two group. Or lipid nanophysical and polymeric nanoparticle. Here actually my research using lipid nanophysical, but this is the concept of lipid nanophysical. Here's some lipid nanophysical that is well used for enhancing skin penetration on transdermal dosage form. The first is liposome. Liposome already the first lipid nanophysical that development of the lipid nanophysical is liposome. Others maybe analog or derivative of liposome. Liposome, nanosome, ectosome, transetosomes, transversome, phytosome. And this is different. This actually this nanoparticle, but based on lipid. I'm going to discuss briefly liposome. This is the structure of liposome. Main component of liposome is phospholipid, and usually liposome is a combination of phospholipid and cholesterol. They make a physical with a bilayer here. Usually drug can entrap in the core. Is the head, this hydrophilic head here, and the tail is hydrophobic. So if we use a hydrophilic drug, so the drug can entrap here in the core on or here. And if we use a hydrophobic drug, so the hydrophobic drug can entrap here, the area on the tail. Liposome have a have a few kind of agent that we know. This MLV, LUV, and SUV. This MLV, multilamellar large vesicle. This large vesicle with multilamellar bilayer. So produce a large vesicle. And another one is LUV, this large unilamellar vesicle. This liposome consists only one layer, bilayer, one bilayer, unilamellar. It's actually bilayer, but just one layer. That's different. Bilayer, but not many bilayer, not like MLV. But this LUV produce a large vesicle compared to another one, SUV, small unilamellar vesicle. Okay. Another one is neosomes. So neosome is actually non-ionic liposome. Non-ionic liposome containing non-ionic surfactants, like twin or span. So the phospholipid replaced with non-ionic surfactant like twin and span, and formulated together with cholesterol. This is some hypothesized mechanism of action of this neosome, how the neosome can penetrate to the skin better than the liposome. These are some hypothesis, some theoretically. First, neosome release a drug molecule in the stratum corneum, here. And another theory said that liposome adsorb and fusion with stratum corneum and release the drugs in epidermis after penetrate to through the stratum corneum. And the other one, neosome intake to the stratum corneum, break and release the drug. And another theory, component of neosome act as penetration enhancer and absorb to the skin via intracellular route. Yeah, like here. Yeah, and enter the dermis and release the drug, or this through appendageal route through hair follicle. Another one is ectosome. Ectosome is more development from liposome. In the ectosome, this vesicle contain alcohol, usually ethanol or isopropyl alcohol, around 20 until 45%, maybe. So the ectosome contain phospholipid and some ethanol or isopropyl alcohol. Some ectosome can consist of cholesterol also. And close to autosome is transautosome. Transautosome. Transautosome similar to the autosome. However, in a transautosome consisting of an H activator. This H activator is a surfactant. Can be twin, span, or other surfactant here. And here binary autosome, there's some addition of propylene glycol or isopropyl alcohol. Oh yeah, well, the drug can entrap here in the core or here in the hydrophobic in the hydrophobic tail. And another type of nanophysical is transversome. It's transversome. Transversomes still contain almost the same, almost similar with liposome, contain phospholipid, but transversome contain ethanol and also surfactant. Another name of transversome is deformable liposome. Since this physical can change the form like this here. The form of this transversome is this the transversome is spherical. And from the trans epidermal root, this through intercellular root, the transversome can deform the physical to be thin, tiny like this, and enter another layer under the stratum corneum until deeper to dermis and meet blood vessels in the dermis. But liposome cannot. Liposome rather a bit more solid and cannot deform. So liposome is spherical and still spherical. So when we formulate the liposome, the size of this particle should be very, very small in the range of nanometers. These are the differences between transversome and liposome. Another type is phytosome. Why the researcher always compare with liposome? Because yeah, the mother of the physical is liposome, the first liposome. Others just development of the liposome development. Phytosome usually use to entrap hydrophilic phytoconstituent. So usually phytosome for the beginning phytosome use to entrap hydrophilic extract or hydrophilic herbal bioactives. The mechanism is different with liposome. In the phytosome, the hydrophilic constituent is entrapped in the polar head here, because the polar head is hydrophilic. And make a complex. There is covalent interaction between active constituent, hydrophilic active constituent from plant extract and with phospholipids on the liposome. For the liposome, the no chemical interaction between drug molecules and phospholipid. So when we prepare liposome, usually we check the interaction. We check whether the complex, yeah, this complex form or not by infrared examination test like that for the liposome. So the liposome is suitable to suitable as a carrier for hydrophilic drug or usually hydrophilic bioactive from plant extracts. Another type is lipid nanoparticles. The first generation from the lipid nanoparticles is solid lipid nanoparticles. Why they call lipid nanoparticle? Usually, before, nanoparticle is from polymeric, not from polymer, not from polymer, not from lipid. The first generation is solid lipid nanoparticles. Here the scheme. Solid lipid nanoparticle. So solid lipid nanoparticle, no, just one layer, not bi layer, not by layer. Yeah. Is the, you can read. Actually, this SLN close to emulsion maybe, but here, when we prepare, when they prepare SLN, we only use solid lipid. Solid, not no liquid lipid, no oil, solid lipid. We blend with the organic solution or decrease the particle size by high pressure homogenizer or high shear homogenizer. So, and disperse this small particle of lipid or lipid nanoparticle in water, and if necessary, stabilize with preferable surfactant. Usually, we use surfactant, or sometimes we use not water but buffer phosphate to stabilize the active ingredients. To active ingredients, so the water we can change with phosphate buffer, and to increase the stabilization of this lipid nanoparticle, we add some surfactant. And the second generation is NLC or nanostructure lipid carriers. This close to SLN, but in the NLC there are addition of oil, of liquid lipid of oil. Forget SLN. Yeah, in the NLC, ratio of the solid and liquid lipid can be between 70 to 30 until maybe 99% solid lipid to only 1%. Liquid lipid, but another reference said NLC can be only containing 0.1% oil or liquid lipid. So most of the component is solid lipid. So the scheme like this in NLC because they containing a liquid lipid. It impact to the melting point also, impact also to the how the drug disperse in the particle. In the SLN like this, yeah, rigid, more rigid, the drug rigid in the solid lipid in the SLN, but in the NLC, the drug can be dispersed in the liquid lipid here, more flexible, most flexible depend on the how much the liquid lipid or oil in the NLC formulation that we use. And also the NLC can be contain preferable surfactant and buffer. And yeah. And another physical is polymeric nanoparticles. Actually, polymeric nanoparticle appear first compared to the lipid nanoparticle. This just a scheme is from a polymer. That and the form maybe many type, but this a big one. But I divide it two type, nanocapsule. Which the drug entrap in the core in the core of nanoparticle, and nanospheres in this form. The drugs disperse in all polymer, in all matrix. Usually, some researchers using biodegradable polymers, even though synthetic polymer or natural origin polymer. It's just a scheme, I think. Because this nanoparticle from solid polymer, usually the particle spherical form, but rigid like liposome. But different case if we use polymer not for nanoparticle but for missile, but I'm not include that missile in this lecture. Another strategies is using energy driven methods, usually using electrical the energy from battery or to electricity. That already on the market is ion topoisis here. Topoisis is already on the market using bipolar electric field here, anode and cathode for bipolar electric field to push to propel molecule. Usually ionic molecule to pull ionic molecule across intact skin into underlying tissue. If the drug is a cationic drug or natural drug, we put the drug underneath the anode. And if the drug is anionic, we put the drug in the cathode here. So this energy usually power supply in this form is a battery, small current, small voltage. So already in the market. And another type, sonophoresis. This using a power supply also, but electricity. But this electricity is to facilitate to produce ultrasound wave through here ultrasonic transducer. Now here transducer, and the drug solution here put on the skin and use the probe, and this ultrasonic transducer produce ultrasound wave and ultrasound wave produce bubble, bubble that disrupt lipid layer. So the drug here can penetrate to stratum corneum and enter the blood vessel in dermis. And another one, electroporation. It also use power supply electricity. That difference with sonophoresis. This transducer not for ultrasound but for pulse transducer. Almost the same. Give the pulse in the range is usually 20 kilohertz until 100 megahertz here. And because of pulse wave here, the pulse wave here can create aqueous pores in the lipid bilayer. So disrupt lipid bilayer and form micropores in lipid bilayer on the stratum corneum. Because the stratum corneum produce micropores, so the drug on the top of the skin can penetrate easily through stratum corneum and then easily enter the dermis and meet blood vessel again. And the last method by stratum corneum bypass. First, tape stripping. I think it's easy to understand using the adhesive tape here in the stratum corneum, and then put off the tape and the stratum corneum peel off here in the adhesive tape. So a thin layer of stratum corneum peel off. So if the drug apply here, transdermal drug apply here, the barrier, the stratum corneum barrier remove, and the drug easily penetrate deeper under the stratum corneum. And another type, microscissioning, usually using aluminum oxide particle. This is like maybe like scrub but not scrub. But remove stratum corneum in thin layer. One layer maybe in stratum corneum. So since stratum corneum remove, yeah, it should be easy. For drug to penetrate to until dermis. But these two methods usually result irritation. Depend on the person, but usually also the irritation because this adhesive tape stripping or this removed by micro-scissioning. Another recently mentioned is using microneedles. Nowadays you saw neural needle the height of micro many reference give a different range about the height of this microneedle. Some reference say 25 until 200 micro in the diameter here, say around 1 micrometer. This the magnification, so the concept is easily just put like needle, but many needle and micro in the skin. And if we put off this, it's not contain drug, it's the first generation contain drug. So we can see the stratum corneum here on the skin produce pore. Yeah, it's possible because of stepping of these microneedles. That here we is our researcher, Papa Nelly, is research in the microneedles. It's many types of microneedles. The first type of microneedle is solid like this. This is the same this one. We put the microneedle. And if the stratum corneum already produce micropore, and we apply this pitch. So tap the skin and put off and apply the pitch. So the stratum corneum barrier already removed here, and the drug in the pitch on the in the pitch easily penetrate because no stratum corneum barrier. Then we can see another type. This type because the time, yeah, many this coated. So this type coated with drug, and when this put off the microneedle, the drug can dissolve and see how low. There's some hollow here in the microneedle, and this drug solution in the reservoir. And because there's hollow, so stop the skin and the drug solution enter, and the dissolving is almost the same, but only this polymer and the drug here, and this the hydrogel. This reservoir also, and the polymer here swell and facilitate drug in the reservoir to enter the dermis. And now, because I have time again, maybe just one research. This our research about solid lipid nanoparticle of Peter Mellon fluid fraction for transdermal delivery. For the here, we research about quarantine that consists the containing in Peter Mellon fruit or PMF, Peter Mellon fruit quarantine. Actually containing two molecules, the molecule stigma sterol glucoside and beta sterol beta glucoside, and this molecular weight be more than 500 dalton. So we need some enhancement if we want to deliver this quarantine of this fraction, this BMF fraction, through transdermal delivery. This the preset we extract by ourselves. I want to skip, and this the formulation of SLN contain beta melon fraction. Okay, so we already published the we formulate using Hysher with the method Hysher homogenization and follow by sonication. Then characterize this SLN and also stability study and doing in vitro penetration study using transfusion cell and use skin of speculum rats. And besides that, also try in vivo anti-hyperglycemic and hypopathological study. We use diabetic rats induced by streptozotocin and nicotinamide because we want to make type 2 of diabetes. And because of the data of orally of SLN contain BMF? Not yet. So we also do two route, thermally and orally, with three dose. This the and we analyze using SPLC for. This is the performance of morphological of SLN of BMF using transmission electron microscope. Is so the physical, spherical physical here, yeah. And entrapment efficiency, good relatively. This close 18%. Well, this is a summarize of characterization of BMF flooded SLN. All the formula is spherical and have a particle size under 200 nanometers, and this is suitable to transdermal delivery. And PDI also lowered PDI and weak zeta potential in negative zeta potential. Stable stability study, the reveal that this BMF loaded solid lipid nanoparticle stable in the room temperature and also in the cold temperature, 7 degrees Celsius. Still above 90% until 3 months. This pH, and but the problem is here, the problem, because there's some aggregation of a particle. Even though the chemically stable, but physically, according to the particle size, it's not stable. So this challenge to us to improve this result, how to make this particle size still stable in the smaller size. Zeta potential, not also change. And for in vitro penetration study, this profile is linear. And this flux value of SLN contain meter melon fraction. For the formula one, highest flux 9.3 milligram per centimeter square hour here, is close to the zero order. So we selected SLN F1 as the base of formula. And we do some in vivo anti-hyperglycemic study. This slide SLN it's administered transdermally, and this control for diabetic. And here you can see 14 day post administration transdermal administration. We put in the abdomen. Input in the 14 days after. After first administration of transdermal, this dosage form use every day and check the change of the glucose level on the animal, and we can see in 14 days already blood glucose level already decrease and meet the normal glucose level here compared to diabetic still in the high. Yeah, this was transdermal, and orally it's also actually so decreasing in increasing for glucose blood glucose level. But here in 18 days after administration here. And if we compare between orally and transdermally, here we can see the violet here, SLN transdermal for quicker, more rapidly in 14 days already meet the normal glucose level. However, the oral still high. Already we check the significance. This is a significant difference. And the SLN oral is an oral meet the normal glucose level after 18 days. This is pathologically of pancreatic beta cell post administration of SLN orally and transdermally. And the conclusion just so that BMA product SLN transdermally give a better what's it called, bigger fix better to treat the pancreas of the red, yeah, and F here is so the better condition terms after give BMF loaded SLN transdermally and orally. And as conclusion for this research, as I said before, that formula one BMF loaded SLN selected as best formulation, and BMF loaded SLN according to this research could reduce blood glucose level as well as regenerate the pancreatic tissue of diabetic rats. Another research that we do is using andrographic foliage. This from andrographis paniculata or Sambrito. This is a structure of andrographic foliage. It's also a bigger molecule. And this constituent, this bioactive, have low oral availability, only 1.19%. This because have parasystemic and first pass effect metabolism, and also have poor water solubility, and they have polyglycoprotein efflux. This constituent have potential to be used as the anti-inflammatory, as anti-inflammatory for rheumatoid arthritis. Because this problem, this constituent, this bioactive, we formulate into etosome for transdermal drug delivery. This etosome like this, because this andrographolid is hydrophobic, because it's not suitable actually, hydrophobic. So we suggest this constituent entrap in the hydrophobic tail from etosomes. This formulation is already published also. This formulation for etosome contain ethanol and also propylene glycol, and use a processed buffer. And this etosome we formulate again in the gel. So we mention it by andrographic foliate loaded etosomal gel. We use HPMC gel here. For the characterization, the same with the SLN, actually morphology, particle size, data potential, PDI, and entrapment efficiency. Penetration study is also the same using France diffusion cell and also stability study. Here, morphology of andrographic foliate, so spherical foam, thermal foam, in the small diameter, yeah, and range around 100 nanometer. Is a particle distribution of these etosomes. average diameter of diameter average below 200 nanometer PDI, good PDI was below 0.05, and also good zeta potential. Entropic efficiency of these undercovered autosomes high, or 97%, and this then and we formulate into gel, some gel, and this characteristic of the gel. The gel we apply to in vitro penetration study. Is linear. So this and according this data, according this data, so that autosomal gel, especially EG2, have a highest flux here, highest cumulative amount, high flux, and single small lag time. And have the highest enhancement ratio. So we continue this formula, this undercovered autosomal gel formula, to in vivo study. For the in vivo study, we do pharmacokinetic study and also pharmacodynamic study. We use HD rats, 2 months, 200 grams. And then for the pharmacokinetic, we put actually three groups, but every group contain 12 rats. First, for orally, administered orally, and second group, transdermally, containing autosome gel, but group three, this non-autosomal. Containing undercovered but non-autosomal, just undercovered gel with the dose 50 microgram per kilogram body weight. This is the result of the pharmacokinetic study. The result also that here the yellow one is the profile again under area under curve of undercovered autosomal gel applied transdermally. Transdermally have a high area compared to undercovered gel, this the green one here, and compared to oral. The orally is very small because there are some presystemic metabolism and first pass effect for the oral route for the this undercovered. There's a data for the AUC and other pharmacokinetic result. I will fast because at the time. And the last is the pharmacodynamic study. We parse the animal groups. We divided the animal group to be six groups. Normal, negative control, positive control, and dose 1, 2, and 3. In this study, we prepare chronic inflammation induced rat. And this study is still ongoing, so the data are not complete yet, still ongoing. We use a CFA method, complete fat adjuvant method, to induce chronic inflammation on the animal, on the experimental animal. And this the research that we got for a while. And here, the three dose of undergraft loaded autosome, so effective decreasing of edema volume here, and almost the same or same with the positive control. We use faucet control is methotrexate injection. Here the faucet control, the blue one. And if we compare with the negative control, even though the control is decreased, and we want to confirm again this reset, and we confirm again this condition, especially for the negative control, because this reset still is ongoing. But if we see this reset, we can see that this underground polyp loaded autosomal gel give edema inhibition effect. And here this percentage of edema inhibition for the positive control using methotrexate injection and underground polyp autosomal gel. This here almost the inhibition close to 80%, but this is still ongoing research, not finished yet. And as a conclusion for this research, that we can conclude is are the underground loaded autosomal gel EGF2 could enhance the skin penetration of underground polyp. Thus, it was selected as the best formulation for transdermal delivery. And transdermal administration of the underground polyp autosomal gel could increase the area under the cuff value compared to the non-autosomal underground polyp gel, and effective to decrease edema volume on the CRF induced rate. And as a conclusion for my lecture before discussion section, first, transdermal delivery system is developed rapidly with various forms and manufacturing methods to increase their effectiveness. And second, the application of nanocarriers for herbal bioactives could be a fascinating and effective transdermal drug delivery system, which provides a significant impact on the enhancement of the bioactive absorption through the skin. And before I close, error. Give that acknowledgement to the Ministry of Research and Technology, and also Universitas Indonesia for the research grant to doing this research, and of course to our project teams. My students, because without the student we can do this research completely, and also the team of Dr. Paulina, Prof. Anton, and Prof. Gumin. And the last, thank you for attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you very much, Professor Sylvia Surini, for the very impressive talk and also presentation. So ladies and gentlemen, let's start the Q&A session. Everyone here is allowed to ask questions, but maybe we open the first three questions. For Zoom participants, please just use the raise hand features, or you can write down your question in the chat box. Okay, is there anyone who want to ask question? All right, maybe for the opening question, I want to ask you first, Prof. Maybe it's just a simple question. In the presentation, Prof. Sylvie mentioned that there is such a lag time for the drug to achieve the plasma concentration after transdermal administration. It is related to the zero order drug release characteristic. My question is there any strategy to cut or to shorten this lag time so patient can obtain a more rapid onset in the beginning, but still have the constant release after the first one? Thank you, Prof.
Okay, thank you for the question. It's a good question. Possible, of course possible. Is the answer? It's possible. So we can how How we can formulate, we can prepare that dosage form with two formula, or in my presentation, maybe the page that provide. Let's share again. Here. This just a example. You can see there's two drug in adhesive, which is concept. This when the liner open and goes to the then and put in the skin. This drug here, could you see my cursor?
Yes, it's there.
Here. Now, the drug in this part will release first. Will release in the what do you call red with different release rate compared to the drug here in the second one. So if so we can say the drug in the first part here will facilitate a fast release. So handling the slow release from the drug here. So we can improve fast release here in the drug in the first layer. If I call this first, and the second layer here, drug here, for maintenance, slower release compared than the drug here in this part. And another modification we can do prepare even in the software on other or other form. Maybe it can answer your question.
Yes, thank you, Prof. It's already clear. So this TDDS is really flexible, right? So we can modify it according to our to our design or to the requirement of what we want to make.
Or mating. If you want too fast, maybe the drug not example not coated with anything, but when we want to put the drug for the maintenance for the slow release, we can coat it. We can coat the drug with another excipient. So the first part for facilitate the fast release, but another part for facilitate the maintenance release for the zero order. So any method, I think.
Okay, thank you so much, Prof. Sylvie. All right, is there any participants here want to ask question to Prof. Sylvia Surini? I think that's a very interesting topic, right? All right, we have one in the chat box from Li Nguyen Long. Would angioedema drastically affect drug absorption? And is there any way to negate negative effects if exist due to the patient already have a reaction to another reactant prior? I'm sorry. Prof. Sylvia, I think you're still in mute.
Sorry, I totally stopped. Okay. Sorry. Anyonya, you mean for the transdermal lucid foam, it should apply on the herb skin. Even though because if we put in the pathologic skin, the penetration or the permeation of drug not the same does the same as when the dosage form or when the drug formulated into that dosage form. Wait a minute. Example. When formulate or when prepare the formulation, example, we want to make red release example 4 milligram per hour example this value of 4 milligram per hour when the pharmaceutical industry develop is when they test to the normal skin. So when we apply that dosage form to disease skin, maybe the red release not 4 milligram per hour, not 4 milligram per hour, not the same. Maybe bigger, because in some skin disease, the stratum corneum is disrupted. The stratum corneum not normal. So maybe the drug enter the circulation can increase. So example, the dosage from release 4 milligram per hour, but no stratum corneum barrier. So it should be faster. So they maybe could be toxic because the drug level in the plasma could be increased. Not same when the dosage from develop. That will get increased. Then if the increase the blood level in the plasma increase, it could be and meet the toxic level concentration. So it will be toxic. Or conversely, this pathologic skin, this is skin, disrupt penetration. So increasing stratum corneum barrier. So usually it should be 4 milligram per hour and entered to the systemic circulation blood vessel, it could be decreased, not 4 milligram, be maybe 2 milligram per hour. And how the impact? The drug level in the plasma not meet the minimum effect to give not meet a minimum concentration to meet effect. So actually for the transdermal dosage form, it should be in a normal, except but usually not normal. Normal, because when we develop, usually researchers try in the normal skin for transdermal. A different case if since beginning the researcher, the developer, think this formulation for dermal, for pathological or for disease skin, is different case. So from the beginning, the formulation for the developer already think the pathological condition of the skin. When I say in this my presentation, sorry, anti-inflammation example, the application of the dosage form not in the plantar, not in the diseased skin, but in the abdomen, different location, different location. I hope my explanation can be clear. Thank you.
Okay. How is it, Mr. or Mrs. Li Nguyenlong? Is it answered your question? Okay, before we close this Q&A session, we have the last question from Jessica Trisina. Prof. Sylvie, thank you for the interesting presentation. May I ask, how's the strategy to choose the right lipid or surfactant types and ratios for the herbal fraction? Is it differ with the conventional pure small molecule? Thank you.
Yeah, good question. We cannot. Okay. We have to try. We have to try. But many reference, many researcher already try. So many reference because that I explained first liposome, maybe from 14 years ago or 15 years ago already exists. So we can follow that composition and change the ratio between which one, lipid or surfactant, lipid ratio lipid surfactant. Some case depend not depend effect also by constituent by bioactives, because we cannot make it the same. Actually, in based on my experience, when I prepare NRC, when I use A extract, I use NRC sample composition 70 to 30 for a solid liquid to a liquid lipid, which already okay, but we change the extract, not A extract but B extract. Maybe it could be the same result, the same particle size, but maybe it's different at all. So, but we can choose a range not very far. Maybe in the another research 70 to 30, but in our research we can do 75 or 85 to 20, something like that. Or we can do such a formulation optimization using RSM example to take detail ratio, maybe 7, 78, 22, like that. And just type depend. Yeah, surfactant, many surfactant. Example first, usually impact to irritation. First, we choose get less irritation if you want to use in skin transdermal. So no irritation to the skin. But another term, example in my case, SLN. I also want to test into the orally. So I have to confirm that surfactant safe for the oral. First safety. Lipid also safety. Safe or not if we apply it for the oral or we apply it for the transdermal. Because even though this excipient, such as lipid or surfactant, can improve penetration, skin penetration, we have to be careful. Sometimes this excipient could give permanent disruption to our skin. So our skin can be not a good, not back to the normal. And it's a many, this we call pre-formulation step to check the safety, the composition, and how to use. And another one, how the interaction, this excipient or lipid and surfactant, of course, to the constituents in the extract, constituents in the herbal, of course. This compatible or not, this give a negative effect or positive effect, something like that. Is it different with compassional force? What do you mean? Different with, what do you mean? Mr. Arif, is it different? What do you mean here? Compassional force?
Is the ratio between the surfactants and the active constituent difference between if we use the bioactives with the chemical ones?
Okay. Ratio. The difference is ratio, right?
Is it me? Maybe it's difference. Yeah.
Ratio. Yeah. Ratio will be the same. Can be the same. Can be different. Yeah. Can be different. We cannot. Fix it, but close. I think if example, I like to make it example because many active ingredients, small one actually easy, yeah. So we back to the simple one. We have to make a equation if this pure small molecule, is categorized to ideal drug for transdermal. If this pure small molecule categorized to ideal drug for transdermal, small molecule under 500 Dalton, coefficient partition between 1 to 4, not too polar. So, what for physical? Yeah, right. But for physical, if there's no problem in this, no problem in the pure small molecule, and it can be penetrated to the skin easily, or not, it's not too easy. Example, maybe we just only this pure small molecule, just put small amount of surfactant enhancer, chemical enhancer, but for physical enhancement. So the question should be, which one enhancement strategy that we have to, that we consider to choose? And then for the advanced, usually some researchers combine that enhancement. Example, chemical enhancer combined with nanophysical sample. Or microneedle combined with nanophysical. Maybe for the special aim, my answer. So for the star, this one we should consider many things. First, of course, from the active ingredients. First, the active ingredients. Yet, how to handle these active ingredients? If for transdermal. Should it give chemical enhancer? Should it formulated in physical, or should be it formulated in microneedle on others? It's the first or second question. When we want to formulate drug to transdermally first. Thank you, Arif.
All right. Thank you, Prof. Sylvie. Maybe I think it's the last question because we've come to the end of today's lecture. All right. Once again, many thanks to Professor Apotekar Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD, for the very, very insightful presentations and also discussion. I would also like to thank FFUI and all the committees for this impressive summer course. And thank you so much to all participants for your kind attention and your active participation during the lecture. hope it will be beneficial for all of us. All right, thank you very much. I will return to Heidi, the MC. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Apoteker Arief Kurniawan, Magister Farmasi. And once again, thank you, Professor Apoteker Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD. And I would also like to welcome the Dean of Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Professor Dr. Apoteker Arianwar, Magister Science, who is present today. And I would also like to once again remind the participants that we have shared the attendance form and evaluation survey in the chat box. Now, as a form of appreciation, the committee would like to give Prof. Sylvie and Apoteker Arief Kurniawan some certificates of appreciation, and the certificate will be given by Prof. Ari virtually.
Okay, thank you, Professor Sylvie, for your very insightful presentation today in summer course 2022 for all participants today in virtually. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Hari. You for participant also.
Okay, thank you to Apoteker Arief Kurniawan today for very nice leader in this lecture, yeah, to guide all session, yeah. So thank you very much for this moment.
Thank
Hope,
you, Prof.
People enjoy of your leadership today.
Thank you, Prof.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Professor Dr. Apoteker Arianwar, Magister Science, for the certificate handover. And now before the honorable speaker and moderator are permitted to leave the meeting room, we'll have a group photo session first. So perhaps the operator can give us the countdown of when we should take the photo.
Okay, I will take a photo for documentation. Please turn on your camera. Okay, I will take a photo in 3, 2, 1, smile. Okay, once again. In 3, 2, 1, smile. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, committee, for taking the group photo earlier. Thank you once again to our honorable speaker and moderator for today's lecture. You are permitted to leave the meeting room now. And now moving on, it is finally time for long-awaited cultural session. So our next cultural session will be presented by BEMFUI 2022's International Relations Department. So hereby, I'll be giving the floor to the International Relations Department to take over.
Good day, passengers. This is your captain speaking. Welcome aboard on Nusantara Airlines flight. The time is 15:51 GMT plus 7. The weather is sunny and nice outside, and you will be able to see the Indonesian islands on your window view once we are on air. The cabin crew will help you guide our flight across Indonesia. Ms. Patricia Heidi, I pass it on to you.
Thank you, Captain Brenna, for the introduction. Hello, everyone. I'm your cabin crew for today, and we ask that you please fasten your seat belts at this time and secure all baggage underneath your seat or in the overhead compartments. We would also ask that you turn off all personal electronic devices, including laptops and cell phones, and also smoking is prohibited for the duration of the flight. And then I'll be coming around in about 20 minutes time to offer you a light snack and beverage. And then the in-flight movie will begin shortly after that. We'll be covering all of the big islands of Indonesia throughout our flight. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Okay, cabin crew, prepare for takeoff.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, as the captain has turned off the fasten seatbelt sign, please open up your window because we're flying over Java Island now. So in Bahasa, we used to call it Pulau Jawa. Pulau means island and Jawa means Jawa. And the first thing I want to introduce are the Javanese traditional clothes. I'm sure you guys must have seen this clothes somewhere, whether it's at a wedding or at the movies. So traditional clothes in Bahasa is called pakaian adat. And we'll start with the left one, which is actually kebaya. So kebaya is an upper garment traditionally worn by women, and the lower garment for the outfit is known as sarong, kemben or kain, a long piece of cloth wrapped and tucked around the waist or under the armpits. Now moving on to the next one, it's called jawi jangkep. So jawi jangkep is a garment usually worn by men. It consists of an upper garment, a kind of formal men's shirt, and then it's almost always asymmetrical because men who wears this upper garment usually holds a dagger on his back. And the dagger is worn as a form of belief that humans are capable of resisting evil temptations in Japanese culture. And then the last one is called solo basahan. So solo basahan is a traditional wedding attire used in Central Java. The main element is called kemben, or a torso wrap, either plain, batik printed, velvet, or any type of fabrics covering the chest. Next, we'll also be moving on to some of the most amazing tourist destinations in Java Island, which is called Borobudur Temple or Candi Borobudur. So it is a 7th century Mahayana Buddhist temple in Magelang Regency, not far from the town of Muntilan in central Java, Indonesia. It is the largest Buddhist temple in the world and Indonesia's single most visited tourist attraction. And while you're traveling, you won't be able to go on without food, right? So here I want to introduce to you guys the three most popular foods from Java Island, which are gudeg, ayam geprek, and bakso mala. So gudeg is made from young, unripe jackfruit, stewed for several hours with palm sugar and coconut milk. And then you can also add additional spices like garlic, shallot, candle nut, or even coriander seed. Moving on to the next one, we have ayam geprek. So ayam means chicken, and geprek in Japanese language means crush. So basically, ayam geprek is an Indonesian crispy battered fried chicken, crushed and mixed with hot and spicy sambal. And the last Japanese food I have here is called bakso malang. So bakso in Indonesian means meatball. And the thing that makes bakso malang more special than other kinds of bakso is the fact that it has more accompaniments. For example, like siomai dumplings, tofu, and yellow egg noodles.
Okay, after traveling to Java, let's fly a bit more to Kalimantan Island or Pulau Kalimantan. For this island, I want to introduce one of the most famous festivals called Cap Gomeh Festival. You can see here in the picture, this is called Barongsai, or Chinese traditional lion dance, which performers mimic a lion's movements in a lion costume. Cap Gomeh, the 15th night. Cap Gomeh is an annual festival that marks the last day of Chinese New Year. It is celebrated 15 days after Imlek, when the full moon will be at its brightest. Chinese descendants all over the world, including Chinese Indonesians, celebrate this day with vibrant festivals. The cities of Singkawang and Pontianak in the province of Kalimantan celebrates the occasion with joyous fanfare. The festival usually includes barongsai, lion dance, performances, lantern parade, and delicious food festival. Traditionally, Chinese Indonesians will celebrate on the eve of March the 2nd with their families, but the overall festival usually goes until March the 4th. After experiencing this joyous festival, it's time for you guys to meet the indigenous people of this island, which are called Dayak people. The Dayaks are one of the native groups of Kalimantan. It is a loose term for over 200 riverine and hill-dwelling ethnic subgroups, located principally in the central and southern interior of Borneo, each with its own dialect, customs, laws, territory, and culture. In the past, the highly developed and complex religious practices of the Dayak people involved numerous local spirits and omen animals. Intertribal warfare was common, with headhunting a major feature. Since the mid-20th century, however, Dayak people have steadily adopted Anglicanism, Roman Catholicism, and Protestantism. By the early 21st century, the vast majority of the population was Christian. Historically, these riverine people lived mostly in longhouses communities, seldom with more than a few hundred members, and traced their descent through both the male and female lines. The economy is based by the shifting cultivation of hill rice for subsistence, as opposed to sale. Now, imagine after getting to know the Dayak people, they take you to the most famous tourist destination in Kalimantan called the Derawan Archipelago. Derawan Archipelago is Indonesia's largest nesting site of the rare and endangered giant green turtles and hawksbill turtles. It features 872 species of reef fishes, 507 species of coral and invertebrates, including protected species.
And now moving on to the third island, I want to take you guys. It's called Sumatra Island or Pulau Sumatra. So I'm sure you guys must be tired after traveling from two islands. So why don't we try to have a taste of one of the most famous Indonesian food, not only famous in Sumatra, but I'm sure it is famous in the whole of Indonesia as well. And the name is actually rendang. So rendang is a Minang dish originating from the Minangkabau region in West Sumatra, Indonesia. Rendang is often described as a rich dish of meat, most commonly beef, that has been slow cooked and braised in a coconut milk, seasoned with the herb and spice mixture until the liquids evaporate and the meat turns dark brown and tender, becoming caramelized and infused with rich flavors. So continuing on, after getting ourselves full of with all these rendang, imagine we're taking a walk in the forest and then suddenly we all see a very huge flower. And it is actually called Rafflesia, or usually known by Rafflesia arnoldi, as the most famous species of this Rafflesia genus. This flower is the national flower of Indonesia and the world's biggest flower. It was named after Stamford Raffles, the leader of the expedition who found this flower. Now, after admiring the beauty of Rafflesia, we finally reach our final destination in Sumatra, which is Lake Toba. Lake Toba is a large natural lake in North Sumatra, Indonesia, occupying the caldera of a supervolcano. It is the largest lake in Indonesia and the largest volcanic lake in the world. Lake Toba Caldera is one of the 20 geoparks in Indonesia, which is recognized in July 2020 as one of the UNESCO Global Geoparks.
Next, we are flying to the Sulawesi Island or Pulau Sulawesi. First, we get to go to the one of the tourist destinations of Sulawesi, which is Bunaken Marine Garden. Bunaken is an island that is a part of the Manado Bay, approximately a 30-minute boat ride from Manado. Bunaken Marine Garden is rich in plant and animal species, especially fish species. Activities that tourists love include diving in 20 diving spots, snorkeling, water sports, or just sightseeing. Please prepare for the hot weather of Sulawesi because it lies on top of the equator. The wildlife of Sulawesi includes a great range of animals. Some of them are babi rusa, a wild bird species, malio bird, which looks like a cockerel but with a black and white crest, anoa, like a smaller buffalo, and lastly, kuskus, or known as a silent bear. Travelers also love to visit the cultural highlands of Sulawesi, Tanah Toraja and Minahasa. In Tanah Toraja, you can visit traditional villages and witness their ancient burial rituals where they mummify the body of their past loved ones, dress them up, and put them in houses and eventually visit their graves.
Okay, so now we're flying to the most western part of Indonesia, which is the Papua Island. So the most famous tourist destination of Papua is the Raja Ampat Archipelago, or in English, the Four Kings Archipelago. This name is in accordance to the geographic of this archipelago where there is four main islands with 1,500 small islands surrounding them. Raja Ampat and its thick jungle is the home for around 75% of the world's species, which one of them is the symbol of Papua, which is the Cendrawasi bird, or its nickname Bird of Paradise for its out-of-the-world beauty. And then one of the native Papua foods, it's papeda. Basically, papeda is a sago congee, which is made by cooking sago starch with water until it coagulates and forms a glue-like consistency. And papeda serves as a main meal and can be eaten with sayur tumis kangkung, or in some parts in Asia, it's called as the morning glory dish. And there are also indigenous races in Papua Island. Two of them are Dani tribe and Asma tribe. They both have their own special beliefs and their way of living. And the Asma tribe is also famous for its woodcraft too.
After Papua, we are flying to Nusa Tenggara Archipelago, which includes the infamous Bali Island. Bali is located in the westernmost of the Lesser Sunda Islands, with the smaller neighboring islands and provincial capital called Denpasar Bali, is renowned for its diverse and sophisticated art forms, such as painting, sculptures, crafts, and performing arts. One of the most famous Balinese art performances are Tarik Kecak and Barong. Tourist attractions in Bali include Bali's beautiful beaches and temples. Tourists also love to party while watching the sun goes down in Bali beach clubs. If your curiosity for Bali is awakened, let's visit Bali together in the World Congress in 2023, hosted by one of Indonesia's member in associations, Himpunan Mahasiswa Farmasi atau ITB. There are also numerous tourist destinations in the Nusa Tenggara Archipelago besides Bali. We have Labuan Bajo. Labuan Bajo is the eastern part of Nusa Tenggara, which is said to be paradise on earth with picturesque views. Next, we have Komodo Island with beautiful beaches and wild bushes, often called the nation's hidden gem. This habitat of Komodo dragon was crowned as one of the world's seven wonders in 2012. On to the next destination, the Pink Beach, which is one of the seven pink beaches in our planet Earth. Tourists can relax and sunbathe on this fairy tale-like beach, do water sports, or just have a leisure swim. The traditional food of the Nusa Tenggara Archipelago are divine. We have Sei Sapi, which is technically a smoked beef, but with special spices and sauces. And then we have Lawar Ikan, and Ikah Kuah Belimbing, which is a fresh fish soup cooked with star fruit and vegetables. There are also a few indigenous races in Nusa Tenggara. Two of them are Atoni and Manggarai tribes.
Okay, thank you so much everyone for participating in our in-flight introduction. So right now we have landed in Soekarno-Hatta International Airport, and please check around your seat for any personal belongings you may have brought on board with you, and please use caution when opening the overhead bins as heavy articles may have shifted around during the flight. I'll give the floor back to Captain Rena.
Thank you for flying with Nusantara Airlines, and we are looking forward to seeing you on board again in the near future. Have a nice day, everyone.
Okay, thank you so much to the International Relations Department of BMFUI 2022 for the long-awaited cultural session of this virtual summer course. Unfortunately, that also marks the end of today's event. Most prominently, I would like to express my utmost gratitude to the Dean of Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Professor Dr. Apoteker Ari Anwar, Magister Science, Vice Dean for Academic Research and Student Affairs, Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Dr. Apoteker Fadna Chani Saputri, Magister Science, Vice Dean for Resources, Venture and General Administration, Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Dr. Apoteker Sutrio, Magister Science, Chairman of the Board of Professors of the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Professor Dr. Apoteker Hayun, Magister Science, and then the Chairman of the Academic Senate of the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Dr. Apoteker Iskandar Syah, Magister Science, and all managers, Head of Program Studies, and coordinators, as well as the honorable speaker for today's lecture, Professor Apoteker Sylvia Surini, Master of Pharmaceutical Science, PhD from the Laboratory of Pharmaceutics and Pharmaceutical Technology, the honorable moderator who have moderated today's session, Apoteker Arif Kurniawan, Magister Farmasi from the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, the honorable professors, lecturers, and all faculty members who have attended today's lecture, and I would also like to thank all the participants who are present today. Lastly, I apologize for any mistakes. May the summer course brings and provides us all with new values, knowledge, and insights about pharmaceutical science. Thank you for attending UI's first ever virtual summer course, 2022 Advances in Pharmaceutical Science. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, everyone. Apologize to all the participants. So before we end this event, I would like to pass the floor to the Dean of the Faculty of Pharmacy, University of Indonesia, Professor Dr. Apotheker Arianwar, Magister Science, for some closing remarks. To Prof. Ari, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Heidi. Yeah, it's time to close this session of the summer course. More than weeks, yeah, since 18th, August 18th, yeah, there is a 8 lecture participate in this summer course. So I hope all the lecture will give insight to all students, and hope the next session of or next year's summer course will be in the real life and real meeting in summer course. I hope many participants come from abroad. Thank you. Hope enjoy all this meeting, lecture, and I close this summer course officially. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Waalaikumsalam, Prof. Izin leave ya.
Okay.